Doctor Who The Rescue by Ian Marter. Read by Maureen O'Brien. Editor's note. Shortly after completing work on The Rescue, Ian Marter died. It was a great loss to his publishers and to the world of Doctor Who as a whole. Ian loved his work on Who, both as an actor and a writer of many of the novelizations of the TV shows. He especially enjoyed and appreciated the interest fans showed in his work. And in his absence, it's to all his fans that I'd like to dedicate this, his last book. N.R. Prologue. The huge curved navigation console hummed, and its multicolored displays flashed their tireless sequences of vectors and coordinates, endlessly mottling with garish lights the pale faces which hung disembodied in the semi-darkness of the smooth metal. Someone sniggered. An elbow clad in glossy white plastic shot out and gouged invisible ribs. "Hear that, Oliphant? 69. Young trainee navigator Oliphant turned his head, wincing in the sudden flare of the Axion radar scanner. "All right, so we have 69 hours to Dido orbit." There was a pause.
69, growled an American voice out of the pulsing gloom.
Oliphant turned back to the reddish ghostly cube of his three-dimensional crossword puzzle, shimmering at the focus of its portable hologram plate, and frowned in frustration. "Too many letters," he snapped defensively, touching a sequence of keys. There was a laugh from around the curve of the console behind him. Plastic-suited figures nodded and grinned at one another. Oliphant stared defiantly at the new letters appearing in the appropriate little boxes of the laser grid.
"I've got it! The answer's stranded! It fits every angle!"
"Does it, Oliphant? You lucky boy," drawled the rich bass American voice.
An older man with a shock of grey hair stood up and leaned over Oliphant's shoulder to study the puzzle.
"Stranded. It is oddly appropriate," he said quietly. "How long have they been on that godforsaken planet, anyhow?"
demanded a gruff voice from the shadows. The tall grey-haired man zipped up the top of his gleaming white tunic.
"Approximately 3 months, I think," he said.
"Exactly 13 terrestrial weeks, Commander Smith," Oliphant informed him smartly.
"Thank you, Einstein," scoffed the gruff voice.
The distinguished older man held up his hand for attention.
"We are about to enter the zone of turbulence reported by Astra 9 before the accident," he reminded them. "I want extra vigilance in here from now until orbit is established."
He turned to the big, sprawling American seated at the pilot position in the center of the crescent-shaped console.
"Mr. Weinberger, keep a close watch on the systems, please. We do not want to find ourselves being thrown out of curvature at the last minute like those poor devils in Astra 9.
The sandy-haired American nodded and gave a lazy half-salute.
"Sure thing, Commander. You can leave it to me," he drawled,
chewing energetically and grinning red and blue and yellow in the lights of the guidance display as it flashed up a new sequence of vectors in front of him. Smith glanced briefly around the navigation module and then strode to the wall and passed his hand across a sensor pad. A panel slid noiselessly aside.
"Wake me at once if there is any problem," he ordered.
He left the module and the panel slid shut behind him. Weinberger swung his padded seat around and punched unnecessarily at several keys on the navigation computer.
"Hell, this has got to be the most boring assignment I've landed yet," he muttered, staring morosely at the maze of graphics that instantly appeared.
He unzipped a pocket on his tunic and took out a fresh sachet of gum.
"Seems one hell of a way to come, just to salvage a couple of emigrants, even if one of them is a dame."
Suddenly, trainee Oliphant leaned forward and frowned at a mass of numbers in one corner of a display.
"Something is wrong here, Mr. Weinberger," he exclaimed, his scarcely broken voice cracking hoarsely.
"You stick to your goddamn puzzles," snapped the pilot with a contemptuous sneer,
chewing the fresh wadge of gum with exaggerated contortions of his thick lips as he punched more keys.
"There is something here, Chief," warned the gruff voice in the shadows at one end of the console.
Weinberger swung his chair and squinted through his tinted glasses. His craggy face immediately folded in concern.
"Must be a fluctuation surge," he said, with a nervous laugh. "We've had them before on this trip."
Oliphant shook his head.
"This is not spurious, Mr. Weinberger."
He pointed to the ominously changing numbers on the screen.
"We have an intense monopole field somewhere nearby. It is increasing every second."
"Check it,"
Weinberger rapped, clearly rattled. Oliphant touched a rapid sequence of keys on the navigation panel. The display flashed check run, and the numbers disappeared for a moment. When they reappeared, they were even more alarming.
"The kid's right,"
said the gruff voice, as the other personnel peered over Oliphant's head.
"We have a powerful magnetic monopole field, and it is closing in around us fast."
Oliphant swallowed, and his prominent Adam's apple jumped in a spasm of nerves.
"Perhaps this is what happened to Astra 9,
he croaked, his scared face bluish in the light from the screens. Next moment, the displays went berserk, in brilliant, multicolored flashes of random graphics and number sequences all over the complex curved console. Then they all blanked out. No one spoke for a moment. The gaping personnel felt their mouths dry as sandpaper. Their hair prickled and stood on end, and their skins felt brittle and crackly as they stared at the dead instruments. Suddenly, Oliphant sprang out of his seat as a livid blue spark spat between his fingers and the computer keyboard.
"Good God, what was that?"
Weinberger gasped, jumping up and moving away from the console. The module flooded with an intense blue light, and a hollow bellowing and scraping noise resounded throughout.
"And what is that?"
Oliphant screamed, pointing wildly into the space above the silent console. The incredulous crew stared at the blurred and hazy oblong shape, which was gradually forming in the shimmering air. They covered their ears as the noise rose to an unbearable intensity. After a few seconds, the blinding glare forced them to shut their eyes and turn away, their unprotected hands and faces burning in the dry electric atmosphere. Suddenly it was silent. The glare vanished. The air felt cold and clammy. Slowly the crew opened their eyes and turned towards the console. The mysterious blue shape had gone, and the systems were once again flickering and humming to themselves. Oliphant gingerly wiped his glistening face and shivered.
It was like...
He stammered, pressing himself against the cold wall. Inside his plastic tunic, he was soaked in perspiration.
"I saw something like it once,"
Weinberger croaked, blinking and shaking his head at the empty space above the console. Pulling himself together, he moved to his seat and checked the instruments.
"All systems checking out normal,"
he reported in an artificially calm voice.
"No indications of magnetic anomaly. Routine cross-check."
Gradually, the others resumed their seats, still numb with shock.
"We established Dido orbit in 68.9 hours,
Weinberger announced, chewing hard. Once the systems had all been cross-checked, the personnel relaxed a little but hardly spoke. They kept their attention on the quietly functioning instruments, intently watching for any indication of hidden effects from the terrifying upheaval they had just experienced. After a long time, Trainee Oliphant happened to glance across at his hologram puzzle. He laughed nervously.
"Whatever it was, it scrambled all the letters," he said.
Chapter 1. The sudden twists of wind seemed to erupt out of nowhere, drawing up the hot sand in fierce corkscrews of stinging grains, which funneled high into the air before abruptly collapsing in gentle sprinkles as the wind dropped, as mysteriously as it had risen. The air was hot and bone dry. The tawny murk of the sky held no clouds, its monotonous haze broken only by the dull ochre patch where the reddish eye of the planet's nearer sun managed to pierce the dusty atmosphere. And the air was charged with electricity, as if a raging thunderstorm could break out at any moment. The parched landscape looked as if it would welcome a torrent of rain falling for years and years. Scattered across the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.